Greetings to all my dear students. So today, in this session, we will be understanding the poetry, The Listeners, by Walter de la Mare. And it is a great poetry as it describes about some supernatural things which would definitely grab your attention towards it. So here, it's Walter de la Mare published The Listeners in 1912 as the title of the poetry of his second collection. It remains one of his most famous pieces of writing and reflects the author's fascination. Yes, students, the author was very much fascinated with the mystery and the supernatural things. So the poetry tells the story of an unnamed traveler. Yes, in this particular poetry, we are not knowing the name of traveler. He's unknown. And he approached an abandoned house. He approached an abandoned house seemingly inhabited by the ghosts. Yes, here the poet has actually added the element of ghosts, the supernatural beings. But it leaves the readers in many questions as to who these entities actually are, unanswered. So here is. So the genre of the poetry is mood oriented and possibly it's a supernatural poetry. The setting is done in the woods, in the middle of the woods, that means a forest. Here is a secluded house which is not visited by many, though the lack of specificity in the time or place gives the setting of an earth otherworldly feel where nobody lives and it's an abandoned house. So the theme of the poetry is that the place of the man in universe which is far greater than he and which he can neither connect with nor understand. So it basically focuses on a man's state of isolation and disharmony with the natural world. Nature as represented here, like the horse who's munching the grass continuously and the bird who got frightened by the man's disturbing clamor, is normally serene. They are not bothered about anything, but it is the man, yes, only man who's anxious, who's worried because of his separateness. So the traveler tries to overcome his aloneness and establish the meaning by frequently knocking the door again and again for the people living there. He has made a promise long time ago. So he's come here to keep that promise. But the natural world remains unyielding in keeping its distance. And the traveler continues to be alone. He starts where a traveler comes on his horse and he says, "Is there anybody there?" So, the poetry starts with a question. The question that the traveler is making. The traveler says, an unnamed figure, that is a traveler, knocks on the door of a house in the moonlight and asks if anybody is there inside. So, there was a lone house where nobody was there. So, knocking on the moonlit door, that means the rays of the moon were actually falling on the door. That is why it was a moonlit door. So this is an imagery that the poet has tried to create. And when he was actually knocking on the moonlit door, he asks, is there anybody there? Why he said so? His horse was continuously champing the grass. His horse in silence, as there was silence all over because it was a forest and the forest floor was covered with the ferns, and the horse was continuously champing the grasses. So here, students, as we got to know, the traveler has come and as he was knocking the door, the horse was not bothered about it and in the silence, he was champing the grass continuously. So here, champing the grass is onomatopoeia. Yes, the sound that is created by the word, this is a literary device, of the forest's ferny floor is an imagery. That means the floor is covered with the ferns. The ferns have outgrown on the forested area, and that is why all the floor of the forest is covered with the fern. It is also an alliteration because forest, ferny, floor, in these words, their first alphabets are repeating continuously. And a bird flew up out of the turret above the traveler's head, and he smote upon the door once again, a second time. So here, the bird flies out of a small tower on the house and over the traveler's head. The traveler knocks again, now more forcefully, and again he repeats his question, is there anybody there? So there the traveler is waiting for the response, where the bird, a part of the nature, flew away by the continuous knocking of the traveler on the door, and the bird flew up over the traveler's head. Again, the traveler knocked on the door. Is there anybody there? He said. So, this shows the anxiety of the traveler, which he is showing by knocking the door. But no one descended to the traveler. No head from the leaf-fringed sill leaned over and looked into his grey eyes, where he stood perplexed and still. So the traveler knocks again more forcefully, and he repeats his question. But no one comes down from the house to meet him. No one even leans out of the window, yes, the sill of which is covered in leaves, to look at him. That means it was an abandoned house, and nobody was there to look into his grey eyes. And he stood there, puzzled by the lack of an answer. So here, leaf-fringed sill is an imagery. That means the sill of the window was covered with the leaves that have outgrown, and the grey eyes, again, an imagery. But only a host of phantom listeners that dwelt in the lone house then stood listening in the quiet of the moonlight to that voice from the world of men, stood thronging the faint moonbeams on the dark stair. So inside the house is a group of ghostly beings. Yes, here the poet actually adds the supernatural beings. These listeners stand in the moonlight as they listen to the human voice that is coming from outside, that is of the traveler. The ghostly beings crowd around the staircase onto which the moonlight is streaking, is falling, as the quiet atmosphere in the empty house is disturbed by the sound of the traveler's lonely voice that goes down the empty hall, hearkening in air, stirred and shaken by the lonely traveler's call. So outside, the traveler senses a strange presence in the silence that meets his question. And in the empty hall, there is somebody who's actually stirred, who's actually disturbed. The quiet atmosphere in the empty house is disturbed by the sound of the traveler's lonely voice. And he felt in his heart their strangeness, their stillness answering his cry, while his horse moved, cropping the dark turf neath the starred and leafy sky. So here, outside, the traveler senses a strange presence in the silence that meets his question. And the horse is continuously undisturbed, continuously grazing the dark forest, the sky above which is full of stars, and the leaves are coming in between. So here the strangeness of the place is described, where everything is very still and even the stillness is answering. He feels some strangeness in the atmosphere. His horse is continuously eating the grass above which there is a starred and leafy sky. Again, children, there is an imagery of the starred and the leafy sky. For he suddenly smote on the door even louder and lifted his head. So the traveler suddenly beats on the door once again, even more loudly than before. And he then calls out, asking, whoever is it listening to pass a message? Yes, he says that I am knocking the door again and again, and whosoever is inside, please pass on my message. So his message was that tell them that I came, and no one answered, that I kept my word. He then calls out, asking whoever is listening, and then he says that please tell them that I came and I kept my promise, and I came here, but nobody answered from it. Never the least stir made the listeners, though every word he spake fell echoing through the shadowiness of the still house, for the one man left awake. So the listeners do not make any motion in response to this. The traveler's words reverberate, they continue to echo through the dark and empty house. Whatever he was speaking, it was reverberating, it was echoing. It was echoing again and again, but no answer was there from inside. It was an empty house and the traveler's words were echoing, and nothing came from the only living persons around. They heard his foot upon the stirrup and the sound of the iron on the stone, and how the silence surged softly backward when the plunging hoofs were gone. So the listeners don't make any noise, and the phantom listeners, the ghosts that are there, present there, the supernatural beings, hear him jump up to the horse, up onto his horse, and then the sound of the horse shoes on the stone path as the traveler rides away. The silence of the forest quickly returns as the sound of the horse forceful riding fades away. So the natural beings heard as he went up to the horse, and the sound of the iron, that means the footsteps of the horse, were heard on the stone, and how silence came back like it was before when the traveler and his horse were gone. So students, there are some literary devices that we will be talking about, which we have just understood in this poem. So the first literary device is alliteration. You know, literary devices are those devices that are used by the poet to create more emphasis on the poetry. So alliteration is the literary device which we use when the same alphabet is repeating continuously. For example, his horse and forest, ferny floor. Onomatopoeia, that is a literary device when with the use of the words we create the sound, like charmed the grass. Imagery. Imagery is the way we actually weave the words to create a picture in the reader's mind, like forest ferny floor, grey eyes, faint moonbeams on the dark stairs. Anaphora. Anaphora is the literary device when in continuation some word is used in order to create a lyrical effect. Stood listening in the quiet of moonlight to that voice from the world of men, stood thronging the faint moon beams on the dark stair. Next is metaphor. Metaphor is used when we compare two things without the use of as or like. Hearkening the ear, stirred and shaken. So children, you know that the ear cannot be shaken. So it's compared to something that can be shaken. Thank you.